Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology. Nice to see you back. I hope you have celebrated Makar Sankranti very beautifully and Bihu and so many other festivals around India. And if you have not yet celebrated, you can also celebrate it today. And today I will speak on a very important topic which many times people ask, but there is no clear answer which they find, and that is, how do we use transits for our benefit? Which means all the planets are transiting in the same place for everybody. Is it? Well, yes and no. We'll see how. We will see why the transits give certain results for somebody and different results for somebody else. Okay. So as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your career or marriage or health, you can always go to the website down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. So what is Gochar basically? Gochar transit. It's like saying somebody is coming to check your room. Whoever is there in the floor, for everybody, the police is coming and checking. All right. Now, suppose you have you know, drugs in your room. Then what happens? You get arrested, hopefully. But suppose you don't have anything bad. You have good things. You know, then maybe they appreciate you and then they spare you. So transits are exactly like that. So a planet, now what is that which is there inside your home? That is your own horoscope and the dashas. And the dashas are decided by the own horoscope itself. So which means if a person is having a particular ascendant, suppose Taurus ascendants, for example. Now, a planet may be transiting. Now, for example, Sun has entered 10th house. Yes, Sun has entered Capricorn, which is the 10th house for Taurus Lagna. And therefore, there are so many people, the 9th house, as I said, so many people will, there are 1/6, you know, 1/12, so 7 billion, or if you take 6 billion, so it's like, it's huge. There are so many Taurus ascendants. So will they have the same flavors of the 9th house? Well, or definitely not. Why? Because whenever the planet will enter the house, so now suppose Sun has entered the 9th house, okay? So Sun will now check what is there in the 9th house of the person. Where is the 9th lord placed? It's like the police is coming and checking. So therefore, if you want to see transits, then just see two things. Which is the if you want to check the transit of Sun, for example. So for Taurus, Sun rules the 4th house because Leo is in the 4th house. So now the 4th lord is transiting the 9th house. So that is the first thing you should note. Then second thing that you should note is, where is the 4th lord originally placed in the horoscope? Which means, where is Sun placed in that person's horoscope? In the birth chart. So if Sun is also in the 4th or the 9th or the 3rd, because from the 9th it will aspect the 3rd, then it's a very important transit, because Sun is, you know, especially if it is in 3-9 axis, then Sun is transiting over natal Sun or 7th, you know, and then it aspects the natal Sun. So then that transit becomes very important. Now the next third thing that you should check is, where is the 9th lord placed in the birth chart? Okay. So who is the 9th lord here? It's Saturn, of course. Saturn rules Capricorn. So you have to check, where is Saturn placed in the birth chart? So suppose Saturn is placed in somebody's 7th house. Then the 9th lord coming to 7, it's a very big Raj Yoga. So suppose somebody is Taurus, for some Taurus Lagna, Saturn is placed in the ninth house itself. That's a great placement, ninth lord in ninth. Or if it is placed in 10th house, it is forming Dharma Karmadhipati Yoga, ninth lord in the 10th. To some extent, of course, not fully. Or suppose Saturn is in the 5th house, so that's a great placement to have. So then we know that this fourth lord transiting the ninth house as the sun is going to be a very prominent time for this person. And also you have to check, the fourth principle is you have to check where is the ninth lord placed in transit. So now where is Saturn currently? Today is 15th. Is it 15th today? Yes. And for the next 9 or 10 days, Saturn will be in Sagittarius still, which is the 8th house for Taurus Lagna people. So therefore, now in transit, it is not well placed because it is 12th, or you could say it is in Adusthana house from the ascendant, of course. So these are four principles that you can use to judge the transits, how the transits will give results. The next principle that you can use is you can check where are the Karakas of these planets, of these houses placed. So for example, if you want to judge the transit of Sun for Taurus Lagna, fourth lord in ninth, you have to also judge where is the fourth lord and the ninth lord in the sorry, who not the lord, as I said, the Karakas for the fourth and the ninth houses. So who is the Karaka for the ninth house? We have Sun and Jupiter, two planets are the Karakas. Okay. Now for fourth house, there are multiple Karakas. Moon is the Karaka, then Venus is the Karaka. Some say Mercury also for education, some say Mars for land. So now, when the fourth lord is transiting in the ninth house, you have to try to see, apart from these four factors, how are the Karakas of the fourth and the ninth houses placed? And now what you do is you can match the two houses. Match means, so for example, the fourth house, if it is, because the fourth house is the house of property, land, real estate, all these things. When it is linked to the trines, it can also show education, because fourth house is the house of primary education also. So this means that the fourth lord, when transits the ninth house, then do you need to check Sun and Mars or Moon or Venus as the Karakas? No, you don't. You have to focus on Jupiter and Mercury, because Mercury is showing education in some way, and Jupiter also. So these are the two common things related to the ninth house, because ninth house also deals with education, higher education. So then when you know that now the fourth lord is transiting the ninth, then you should also see in the birth chart where is Jupiter and Mercury placed. So these are the fifth and the sixth principles. So therefore, once you see their placements, and then you see in which house they are sitting. Okay. So the Karakas will tell you to what extent the fruits of the results will come. Not the results, the fruits of the results. So there's a big confusion about who is the Karaka for children. Is it Venus or is it Jupiter? Well, Jupiter is the Karaka for Jupiter is going to give you the fruits of children, and Venus gives the result of children, which means Venus represents Shukra, the semen. No. Therefore, if Venus doesn't support, you cannot have children. So the result of children is not there. But suppose you have children, how will your children be? That is like the fruit, ultimate goal. So that is decided by Jupiter. So that is why he is the Karaka for children. He is not the Karaka for having children. Okay, will you have children or not? That depends on the fifth house, fifth lord, and Venus. Because if Venus doesn't support, then you cannot have children. It's simply not possible, because it is Sanjeevani. And what is Sanjeevani basically? You are carrying on yourself, right? Your father carried on you. You will carry on your next generation. It's It's very simple to understand. So, therefore, if the Karakas are not well placed, so now suppose in that case, fourth lord transiting the ninth, so fourth lord Sun is well placed in transit and in the Lagna chart, and then Saturn as the ninth lord is well placed in the Lagna chart and also in transits. Let's assume that for Taurus, let us make some fancy assumptions that Saturn is in the 10th and it's forming a great yoga. Imagine in transit, I mean to say. And let's imagine in the birth chart, it's a 9. But now suppose this Jupiter and Mercury are not well placed in their horoscope. Then what will happen? Even if they get those results, they will not be able to enjoy the fruits, basically. It's like, you have a great home, you have a big home. Let's talk with some examples. So you have all the fancy things, the most costly equipments, marble, maybe emerald. But still, you don't get a feeling that you are relaxing. That feeling is not there inside you. Why? Because maybe you are not able to feel that you have come home. Maybe for you that is a house, it's not a home. There's a big difference between house and home. So if the fourth lord is great, then it can give you a good house. But if moon is well placed or Venus is well placed, because they are the primary karakas for home and house, for home especially moon most importantly, then you will be very happy when you go home, go to your house. Or you go home and you feel as if you have come home. But suppose Venus is very well placed as the Karak, but Moon is not well placed, then you will feel that whatever I do in my home, I don't feel as if this is my home. I feel as if I'm somewhere else. And you will be searching where I can go home, when I can go home, when I can do this, when I can do that. So that is how you can judge transits, right? So the Karakas are very, very, very important. And now suppose somebody's 11th Lord transits the 10th house. 11th Lord transits the 10th house. Okay. So in that case, how will you judge this transit? So let's take the example of Taurus Lagna itself. So who is the 10th Lord? It's Saturn. And the 11th Lord is Jupiter. So after 9, 10, yes, so after 2 or around that time, after 2 years almost, you will see that Jupiter enters Aquarius, yes, which is the 10th house for Taurus Lagna. So now Jupiter is the Lord of the 11th, and now it is entering the 10th house. So now how do you judge this? Well, first you see 11th Lord is transiting the 10th house. Okay. So where is Jupiter placed in the person's birth chart apart from transit? These two things. Then the third thing is, where is the 10th Lord originally placed in the birth chart, original birth chart and in transit? So who is the 10th Lord? Saturn. So where is Saturn placed during that time? So during that time, Saturn will also be will again be in Capricorn, hopefully. So then that Saturn is also well placed. Okay, now ignoring the retrogression and other effects of Jupiter and Saturn, or even if Saturn would have entered Aquarius, it would still be a great placement. So then the fifth principle, as I said, you have to see who is the, you have to try to combine the houses. So 10th and 11th, when they come together, they deal with money, especially finances. Huge sum of money, basically. So now, 10th house has so many Karakas. 10th house has, now 11th house is only one Karak, that's Jupiter. So you must consider Jupiter. Then you have to see where is, so now you see again, 10th house has, Sun, it has Saturn, it has Mercury. These three are the primary Karakas, and Mercury is the foremost of the Karakas. But now, because the 11th house is involved, you also have to check Sun, because Sun deals with, you know, power, position, authority, and 11th house is like the gain of that. And Mercury also deals with money. So now you don't have to see Saturn much. You have to see Jupiter, Sun, and Mercury, these three planets. So how are these three planets placed in the original birth chart and in transit? So therefore, very rarely you will see that very good things happen or very bad things happen in your life. Why? Because it is next to impossible that every time all these six factors will either be positive or negative for you. Okay, so sometimes you will see the Karakas are not well placed in your chart or during transit. Or sometimes you'll see the Lords are not well placed in transit, but in your birth chart they're well placed. Okay, so that is why astrology becomes very complicated at times. But the point here is to not make you feel that astrology is complicated or it's very simple. It's not like that. But you have to practice these principles in at least 100 charts. And I have seen when you use these principles, you get beautiful results actually. And the results will depend on all of these factors. And not just, you know, one factor. It's not that, you know, Lagna Lord is transiting, you know, the 8th house. It's going to be terrible. It is not like that actually. Okay. And sometimes they say the 12th Lord is transiting the Lagna, it's going to be horrible. It's not like that. So what if that 12th Lord is very well placed in your birth chart? What if you are running a good dasha? What if the Karaka for the 12th house? Who is the Karaka for the 12th house? Saturn himself. If Saturn is well placed in your birth chart, and maybe it is well placed in transit, because it's transiting the Lagna, so we assume it is badly placed, right? So then you also have to see who is the Karaka for the Lagna. And we have Sun as the Karaka for the Lagna. Where is Sun placed in your birth chart? Where is Sun placed in transit? So these are ways by which you can decipher what kind of things you could expect. Okay. And if you see multiple indications of a particular event happening, and especially the biggest secret I will tell you, the day of the event is going to be linked with the transit of moon, because moon is the mind. Unless you feel it inside your mind, that means the event has not happened. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that it is highly essential that you check the transit of moon on an everyday basis. Not to be fanatical or not to create fear, but to know what things are going to happen. So now suppose the 11th Lord is transiting 10th, and you know Jupiter, Mercury, Sun are well placed, and you know Saturn is well placed. Jupiter itself is well placed in birth chart also. Okay. Then the day when Moon will transit the ascendant, the 2nd, 6th, 10th, or 7th, or 11th, either one of these days. Primarily the 1st, 10th, and the 11th I have seen. Or to some extent the 5th also. So 1st, 5th, 10th, and 11th. Then you will see that there could be some major events, you know, like getting name, fame, becoming famous. These kind of things could be there. Some big achievement could be there if Jupiter and Venus support that. Okay, so therefore we have to use these principles combined, and most important is the dashas. If you do not use dashas, then you will never be able to read what transits are saying. Okay, and therefore first we should check the horoscope, then we read the dashas, and third is we read the transits. But we do the opposite. What we do is we read transits, then we see, oh, dasha. Okay, Venus dasha. Venus means, you know, love, romance. No, nothing like that. Check the chart at the end. That's what we do, right? No. First, we check the chart. We see what is going on in the chart. Nothing, no dasha, no transit, no principle, no Raj Yoga, nothing can overpower a chart. If the chart is inherently very strong, then however bad the dasha is, the person will be able to cope up. And if the chart is terrible, it's a very bad chart. Bad, I mean, not that the person is bad, but the person is not having the motivation to go ahead in life or, you know, see things at a spiritual level. Then even if great things come, till that temporary time, have you seen people very happy suddenly and then miserable for the rest of their life? This is what happens. So better to have a good chart and so-called a bad dasha or a bad transit, rather than having a good transit or a good dasha with a very bad chart. Okay. So that is why we do not get the results of transits the way we expect them to be. Because just because Mercury is transiting your ascendant, it doesn't mean that you will meet a bunch, whole lot of friends. It can happen if Mercury transits the 3rd, 5th, 7th, 9th, and 11th, even then. Alright, so how will you know what kind of friends they are? Well, the chart will tell you. The chart will tell you what kind of friends are you attracted to. And the dashas will tell you who are those people that you will end up meeting ultimately. Okay, so that is it from my side. If you are new to the channel, please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, you can always go down to the description section to find my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him. Thank you very much.